Welcome to the video lecture series in History Class 12th. Today, we will discuss about 6th chapter which deals with Bhakti and Sufi traditions from 8th to 18th centuries. In this chapter, we will deal with 4 subtopics. Those are Bhakti movement in South India, Bhakti traditions in North India, Islamic traditions in India and Sufism, integration of cults, differences and conflict according to historians, and reconstructing histories of religion. So, Bhakti movement in South India. Bhakti movement in South India gives insight into main features of early Bhakti traditions, early Bhakti movements of Tamil Nadu, devotional literature of Alvars and Nayanars, Veer Shaiva tradition in Karnataka, Alvars, Nayanars and Veer Shaivas as critics of the caste system, women Bhakti saints are challenged to patriarchal norms, how and why rulers tried to establish connections with Bhakti traditions, why opposition to Buddhism and Jainism, and adoption of variety of languages by Bhakti saints. Between 8th to 18th centuries, new religious traditions emerged. These religious traditions, they were fluid, where original message was either elaborated by the generation of devotees or occasionally modified or sometimes abandoned certain ideas if they appeared problematic or irrelevant in different political, social or cultural contexts. So, there is dynamism and diversity in these religious traditions. Now, main features of early Bhakti traditions. Early Bhakti traditions, it emerged from South India. These Bhakti saints, they spread their message of unconditional love towards God in regional languages used by ordinary people. As we can see, historians of religion, they have classified Bhakti movement into 2 broad categories. Those are Sagun, that is with attributes, and Nirgun, without attributes. And this Sagun, they are again divided into Alvas, Nayanas, and worshippers of goddess. Sagun with attributes, often they conceptualize their god in anthropomorphic forms, whereas Nirgun means without attributes. They often worshipped an abstract form of God. Secondly, in many instances, examples, poets, saints, they emerged as leaders around whom developed a community of devotees. Thirdly, though Brahmanas, they remained important intermediaries between gods and devotees in several forms of Bhakti, still, they acknowledged women and lower caste who were otherwise considered ineligible for liberation within the orthodox Brahmanical framework. Fourthly, this Bhakti tradition, it was full of variety and hence remarkably diverse. Now, early Bhakti movement of Tamil Nadu. The 2 earliest Bhakti movements of Tamil Nadu around 6th century were led by the Alvars. Alvars means those who were completely immersed in devotion to Vishnu, and by the Nayanars means those who were completely immersed in devotion to Shiva. These Alvars and Nayanars, they travelled from place to place singing hymns in local language, that is Tamil, in praise of their gods. During their travels, the Alvars and Nayanars, they identified certain shrines as abodes of their chosen deities, and often large temples were later built here, and these places, they became their sacred places and developed as centers of pilgrimage. The worship of the images of saints along with the deity, it started. Singing compositions of these poet saints, it became part of temple rituals in these shrines. Now, devotional literature of Alvars and Nayanars. By the 10th century, the compositions of the 12 Alvar saints were compiled. This composition or anthology, known as the Nalayir Divya Prabandham, means 4000 sacred compositions. This composition is frequently described as the Tamil Veda and as sacred and significant as the four Vedas in Sanskrit. The poems of Nayanar saints, namely Appar, Sambandar and Sundarar, they are compiled in the Tevaram in the 10th century. The compilations and classification in the Tevaram is done on the basis of the music of the songs. Veershaiv tradition in Karnataka. In 12th century, emerged a new movement in Karnataka led by a Brahmana named Basavanna, who was initially a Jain and a minister in the court of a Chalukya king. His followers were known as Veershaivas, means heroes of Shiva or Lingayats. They continue to be an important community in the region, that is Karnataka, even today. Lingayats or Veershaivas, they worship Shiva in the form of ling, and men, they usually wear a small ling in a silver case on a loop string over the left shoulder. Those who are held in high esteem, they are called Jangam or wandering monks. They questioned the theory of rebirth and believed that on death, the devotee will be united with Shiva and will not return to the world. Therefore, they do not practice funerary practices such as cremation prescribed in the Dharma Shastras. Instead, they ceremonially bury their dead. Our understanding of the Veershaiva tradition is derived from vachanas, means sayings, composed in regional language, that is Kannada, by women and men who joined the movement. Now, let's see Alvars, Nayanar and Veershaivas as critic of the caste system. According to some historians, the Alvars, the Nayanars and the Veershaivas, they protested against the caste system and the dominance of Brahmanas. This to some extent is supported by the fact that the saints, they belong to diverse social backgrounds, ranging from Brahmanas to artisans and cultivators and even from caste considered untouchables. The Lingayats or Veershaivas, they challenge the idea of caste and the pollution. They disapproved certain practices prescribed in the Dharma Shastras. This won them followers among those who were marginalized within the Brahmanical social order. One of the vachanas composed by Basavanna, it raises question on the rituals. He says, when they see a serpent carved on a stone, they pour milk on it. And if a real serpent comes, they say, kill, kill. To the servant of the god who could eat if served, they say, go away, go away. But to the image of the god which cannot eat, they offer dishes of food. Against caste system, an Alvar named Tondradiyoppi, he says, you, Vishnu, likes those servants who express their love for your feet, though they may be born outcast, more than the Chaturvedins, who are strangers and without devotion to your service. Similarly, Appar, a Nayanar saint, he says, of what use are your Gotra and Kul? Just bow to Marperu's lord. That is, Marperu means Shiva, who resides on the Marperu in Tanjavur, Tamil Nadu. So, just bow to Marperu lord as your sole refuge. By calling the Nalayir Divya Prabandham, that is one of the major compositions of the Alvars, as the Tamil Veda, and claiming it to be as significant as the four Vedas in Sanskrit, that were cherished by the Brahmanas. Again, it is a challenge to the traditional caste system. Now let's see how these women bhakti saints, they were challenged to patriarchal norms. Presence of women saints is an important feature of bhakti movement. For example, the compositions of Andal, she is a woman alwar saint. Her compositions are widely sung till date. She saw herself as the beloved of Vishnu and expressed her love for Vishnu in her compositions. Another woman, Karaikal Ammayyar, who was a Nayanar saint, she adopted the path of extreme asceticism. She challenged the traditional notion of feminine beauty by describing herself as the female demoness with bulging veins, protruding eyes, white teeth, shrunken stomach, red haired, etc. and wandering in the forest Alan Ketu, home of Lord Shiva. These women bhakti saints, they renounced their social obligations of being wife or mother, but did not join an alternative order or became nun. Their very existence and their compositions posed a challenge to patriarchal norms. On the other hand, we see that Lingayats or Veer Shaivas, they encourage certain practices disapproved in the Dharmashastras, such as post-puberty marriage, widow remarriage. Now, how and why rulers tried to establish connections with bhakti traditions? The powerful Chola rulers who ruled from 9th to 13th centuries, they made land grants and constructed magnificent big temples for Vishnu and Shiva. For example, Shiva temples at Chidambaram, Tanjavur, Gangaikond Cholapuram and bronze sculpture of Shiva as Nataraj, they were produced under Chola patronage. Villal peasants, means rich and powerful peasants of South India, they were followers of Nayanars and Alwars, and by supporting these saints, the kings claimed divine support and hence won the support of Villal peasants. Under royal patronage, Tamil Shaiv hymns were compiled as Tevaram. Why opposition to Buddhism and Jainism by bhakti saints? Buddhism and Jainism had been prevalent in the Tamil region for several centuries with the support of merchants and artisans and received occasional royal patronage also. Interestingly, one of the major themes in Tamil bhakti hymns, particularly in the composition of the Nayanars, is the opposition to Buddhism and Jainism. According to historians, this opposition is due to competition between members of those religious traditions for royal patronage. Adoption of variety of languages by bhakti saints. Bhakti saints, they express their opinions in the regional languages, which was easier for common man to understand. Otherwise, their message would not have been communicated effectively and lost with time. So, Alwar and Nayanar saints, they used Tamil language and Baswanna used regional language Kannada to spread his message. So, we discussed about main features of early bhakti traditions, early bhakti movements of Tamil Nadu, devotional literature of Alwars and Nayanars, the Veer Shaiva tradition in Karnataka, Alwars, Nayanars and Veer Shaivas as critics of the caste system, women bhakti saint a challenge to patriarchal norms, how and why rulers tried to establish connection with bhakti saints, why opposition to Buddhism and Jainism by bhakti saints, adoption of variety of languages by bhakti saints. In our next presentation, we will discuss about bhakti traditions in North India. Thank you.